Thank you so much, sir, for explaining that true devotion is actually developing true love for Bhagwan and the grace that God bestows on us in return for this true love. Now, having learned what true devotion is, let's now shift gears and learn what are the various sadhanas that we need to undertake to connect with the Divine Lord. Bhagwan has lovingly explained to us how the continuous Nama Japa controls the vagaries of the mind and over time prevents the mind from wandering away. This journey takes us from Anubhava, Bhavana to Bhava, from Bhava to Anubhava, and this sadhana is called as Japa Sahita Dhyana. May I now request Shri P. Jagannath Prasad Rao, member Shri Sathya Sai National Council, to talk to us on the topic Japa Dhyana Likhita Japa. Sai Ram.
ब्रह्मानंदं परमसुखदं केवलं ज्ञानमूर्तिं द्वंद्वातीतं गगनसदृशं तत्त्वमस्यादिलक्ष्यं एकं नित्यं विमलमचलं सर्वदी साक्षिभूतं भावातीतं त्रिगुणरहितं सद्गुरुं तां नमामि. My salutations at the lotus feet of Bhagwan Baba. Revered elders, brothers and sisters, Sai Ram to you all. In search of the goal, in search of our destination in life, we are now on a 2.5 days voyage to discover Swami, to discover the Infinite Lord, and to discover ultimately that He is only within us. In this search for God, it is a tussle of mind. It is said, mana eva karanam manushyanam bandha moksha. For man's liberation or for man's bondage, it is mind that is responsible. If the mind turns Godwards, we are liberated. If the mind turns towards the indriyas, we are in bondage. And if mind is the only problem, what is the difficulty in eliminating it? Real difficulty lies in the fact that mind is a peculiar thing. In Bhagavad Gita, describing the nature of mind, Arjuna tells Krishna, Chanchalam hi manah Krishna, pramadhi balavad drudham, tasyaham nigraham minni, bayo deva sudhuskar. Krishna, you have been telling me do this, do that, but what I find is, whatever I want to do, mind is a problem. Chanchalam, it is very unsteady. It is fickle. This moment it is here, the next moment it may be somewhere. Chanchalam hi manah Krishna, balavat, it is very strong. Drudham, it is very stubborn. It won't yield easily. Tasyaham nigraham manni, I find it extremely difficult to control this mind. Then Sri Krishna, looking at the fact that Arjuna is a bit nervous, he is despondent, he is thinking in terms of losing the battle, to encourage him, to instill courage in him, Krishna replies, Asansayam Mahabaho. He immediately tells Arjuna, Hare Mahabaho, the great, you are the man with a valor. Asansayam, yes, what you say, I agree, I don't deny that. Manah durnigraha chalam, mind is very difficult to control. But there are two things which can help you in controlling the mind. Abhyasena cha kunteya, vairagyena cha guhyate. There are two things. One is practice, abhyasa, and the other one is detachment. The other one is detachment. Practice and detachment. First thing that you need to know is that if you really want to go near God, you have to avoid the bad things within you. The process of learning and unlearning, Swami says, The unlearning is that which we have within us and which we have to discard. So for that you have to develop detachment. And the practice is practice of japa and dhyana. Practice of japa and dhyana, the two most important things that a sadhak needs to do. This practice of japa and dhyana and this process of detachment. You can't say that I will have Rama and Kama together. Swami says Rama and Kama cannot coexist. If you want Rama, you have to discard Kama. So that sort of detachment, vairagyam, that is essential. I can't just say that I will live a material life and yet gain spirituality. To some extent, material life is to be discarded. So when Arjuna gets this reply, he again thinks of fighting out the battle. So in our life also, these two things are to be taken care of, abhyasam, practice. And the second thing is detachment. We know that. We have read these things in many scriptures. Bhagavan has told us several times about this. But why are we not able to proceed? Why are we not able to proceed? There is a saying in Hindi, in Sanskrit. Janami dharmam nachame pravritti. Janami adharmam nachame nivritti. Janami dharmam, I know what is right. I know what is correct. Yet I am not able to practice it. Janami adharmam, I know what is not correct, what is not proper. Still I am not able to give up. Still I am not give up. So this is my dilemma. I know what is good and I don't follow it. I know what is bad. I don't leave it. So janami dharmam nachame pravritti. Janami adharmam nachame nivritti. So why are you not able to do it? The reason is that I don't have the strong conviction that material life doesn't give me permanent happiness. I have experienced it so many times in my life that material happiness is temporary. But still I cling to it. Still I feel that yes, if not this, that may give happiness. If not that, that may give happiness. My whole life is wasted in searching happiness in material world. In material world. I hear so many things. I hear that spiritual life gives eternal happiness, but I don't follow spirituality. Still I am under the belief that material life only gives happiness. Otherwise just think of people who went to Swami. And what did they want for? What did they seek from Him? Material help. Swami, save me from poverty. Swami, I should get promotion. Swami, I should... All material requirements we often used to tell Swami. And we never said, Swami, I don't need anything, I only need You. Swami, I know You, I don't need anything. And Swami once said, when people come to me with material desires, I fulfill them. I fulfill them, no doubt I fulfill them. But when somebody comes with a faith in me, with a strong belief, with a sincere prayer, Swami, I don't need anything, I only need You. Then I say that He is my bhakta. And for that bhakta, He need not pray to me. I take care of Him. I take care of Him because He wants only me. He is my constant companion. Often we say that Swami is my constant companion. No, we can't say that Swami is my constant companion. If my constant companion is Swami, I will only need Swami. That's why Swami said, to get me, you should have the deservedness. You should have the deservedness to get me. Then Swami says, those who are wanting, those who seek material comforts, I bless them. Yes, you go and have material comforts. Again He comes to me. Swami, I want this. Swami, why I want this? The entire life is wasted like this. But the one who has that strong faith in Swami says, Swami, I only need You. I only need You. Baba says, I don't want You to extol me in bhajans, in praise of me, because praise and blame both are not important for me. I just want, You just need Me. You just need Me. You say from my heart, Swami, I need You. I don't need anything else. And for such a bhakta, I am His constant companion. I take care of Him. It is so simple that Swami says, but so difficult for us to practice. Because when my material longing is not satisfied, I look for options. And those options are another material object. If not this, another material object. I never say that I am at a point where I feel that there are no other material objects, I only need Bhagavan. And once I graduate Bhagavan, I will know what is real happiness is. What real happiness is. Today we have assembled here, not just to get material satisfaction, but to choose a path which is spiritually noble. So at the end of this convention, if I am not convinced that yes, it is spiritual life I need, I need to wed myself to spirituality, then the whole exercise is a failure. This we must realize. Swami came to the earth, he spent 85 years with us, but we failed to understand this. So in this process of reaching a stage where I will need only Swami, there are certain instruments through which I can get nearer to God. After Swami's physical absence from the day of Mahasamadhi, we are feeling a vacuum in our lives. All of us feel it, some to a lesser degree, some to a greater degree. Swami, who was everything for us life, when he left us, we are in a vacuum. And we still feel that loss. And for that, we must connect ourselves to him. I must know how to connect myself to God. God is always present. God is always ever present. Sarvada, sarvakalesu, sarvatra, he is there. But only thing is, how to connect myself to him. How to connect myself to him. So for connecting myself to him, what is needed is intense longing. What is needed is intense longing. And that longing should drive me to a point where I say, Swami, tere siva mara koi nahi hai, tujhko mera pranam. I must be able to say that. Tere siva prabhu koi nahi hai, tujhko mera pranam, o Sai Ram, tujhko mera pranam. Murali manohara asana todo, dukh bhanjan mera saath na chodo, dukh bhanjan mera साथ न छोड़ो. द्वार खड़ा मैं दुखियारी, सुन लो मेरे पुकारो साई राम, तुझको मेरा प्रणाम. दीज टीयर्स दैट रोल डाउन ऑन माई फेस व्हेन आई सिंग ऑफ यू स्वामी, आई ऑफर ईच टीयर एट योर लोटस फीट, बट फॉर यू आई हैव नोबडी एल्स. तेरे सिवा प्रभु मेरा कोई नहीं है, tujhko mera pranam. So this intense longing is what is needed. Radha had that, Meera had that. All those devotees who in the years gone by have achieved God at the very near to them, or have seen God, have realized God, they had that intense longing in them. Radha had that longing for Krishna. So that intense longing we should have to gain a proximity to God. Then these three processes that we are discussing today, japa, dhyana and likhita japa. These three are processes through which we can connect ourselves to God, provided we do these things seriously and sincerely. Japa and dhyana. Japa and dhyana, they are two processes where I sublimate my mind. I sublimate my mind. Because we have to withdraw the mind from the material world and get it focused on the spiritual world. So get it focused means my indriyas are always outward going. They go outwardly to in different directions in the objective world. So I have to bring that, all those desires, all those indriyas and the entire mind, I should focus it on God. For this, I should withdraw the mind, I should withdraw the eye, the ear, the nose, the panchatan matras, sabdasparsa rupa rasa gandha. These five are now in search of happiness in the material world. I should withdraw them, I should withdraw my mind and get it focused on Bhava. This is the process of dhyana. This is the process of dhyana, which has three aspects: concentration, contemplation and meditation. Concentration we should have in our daily life, in small things also we should have concentration. When we apply the mind, when we engage the mind in thinking of the futility of material desires, there is a stage of contemplation. And a meditation is the highest form where I totally merge in Bhagavan. I totally merge in Bhagavan. Once in Vrindavan Kunjaganan, Radha was jealous of Krishna, the flute in the hands of Krishna. Radha was jealous of the flute in the hands of Krishna. She was thinking, how close is the flute to Bhagavan? Bhagavan doesn't leave it even for a moment. But what is my life? People say Radha Krishna, Radha Krishna. But I am not that close to Krishna as the flute is. So one day, knowing Radha's mind, Krishna left the flute in a place and he went somewhere. Finding the flute alone, Radha goes to the flute and asks, "O flute, what is there in you that is not in me for which you are so close to Bhagavan? What is there in you which is not in me for which you are so close to Bhagavan?" Then the flute says, "Radha, there is nothing in me. There is nothing in me. That nothingness gives me Bhagavan. That nothingness gives me Bhagavan. See how hollow I am. See how hollow I am. Inside there is nothing. But Swami loves to take me to His lips and produce the celestial music. So make yourself hollow. Make yourself empty. Make yourself empty. Then only Bhagavan will take you in His hands and lift you to that position." So that is what that day Radha said, and that applies to all of us. We should reduce our wants. We should reduce our dependence in material life. That is the most essential thing in day meditation. In meditation, we must reduce our desires. We should exercise ceiling on desires. Sincerely and seriously, we should exercise ceiling on desires, which will make us hollow enough for Bhagavan to accept it. For Bhagavan to accept it. In dhyana, it is said that the time should be fixed, the place should be fixed, and the object on which you are doing meditation should be fixed. You cannot have dhyana today in the morning, next day in the daytime, in the evening, or the next day in the afternoon. The time should be exact, and at the same time you should do dhyana. And as it has been said, that is to be in the Brahma Muhurta, when things are very still. When the rishis in the Himalayas, they pray Bhagavan for the welfare of mankind. The vibrations are strong. And once you sit, you immediately get the attention. So that is the place. So the time, place should be constant. The time should be constant. The time should be exact. Swami often used to say, if you feed a dog every day at a particular time, for one day or 2 days, you wait for it. The next day it will be coming exactly at the same time and waiting for you to give him food. If dog can do this, why not God? Why not God? So you pray God intensely every time, at the same time every day, you will get God. That was what Swami used to say. So the time should be fixed. And the time, for how long? For how long should I do meditation? For how long should I do puja? Swami once said, forget this how long, then it will be all right. Forget this how long. How many times I should utter the mantra? Forget that time. Once you start counting the mantras, your mind will be on the numbers but not on God. So that's why he said, forget that. You should merge in Bhagavan. You should merge in Bhagavan. And the moment you merge in Bhagavan, you are one with him. You are one with him. Just like Ramakrishna used to say, a sugar doll, when it gets deep into the water of an ocean, it merges, it loses its identity. So also you should lose your identity. And that moment when you lose your identity, that is the exact moment of meditation. That is the exact moment of meditation. Swami, once Ramakrishna Paramahansa was told by Vivekananda, he said, Gurudev, there is a jute factory nearby, and whenever I sit in meditation, that disturbs me. Ramakrishna Paramahansa told, then concentrate on that sound. Concentrate on that focus, put your focus on the sound, you will be all right. This is a peculiar thing. And once Adi Shankaracharya was told that, Swami, I want to do meditation, but I am not getting the attention. I am not getting that concentration. He said, through practice only. You have a piece of paper, you have a lens. The sun rays fall on the lens, and through that lens they pass on to the new paper. And the paper gets burnt. The paper gets burnt because the dispersed rays of the sun, they concentrated on that lens, and the concentration lens, the light came to the paper. So it was so intense, so powerful, that it burnt the paper. So in the same manner, if you do the meditation with that much of devotion and dedication, all the dirt in you will vanish. Jnanagni sarva karmani bhasmasat kurute yatha. So that jnanagni should be generated. Now as regards other things, your previous night decides how good will be today. You should sleep in time. You should wake up in time. If you sleep late and get up late, you cannot do meditation. So one who wants to do meditation should make it a habit to sleep early. To sleep early, to have a sound sleep. For that he should take light food. He should not take spicy food. He should take light food. And if the night is okay, the day will be okay. You can get up in time. Is it necessary for us to take bath before dhyanam? This was also asked by Swami. Swami said, if you are able to sustain your mind in that cool state, even after getting up, for say 15-20 minutes, your mind is not distracted, and within that time, you can carry on your daily oblations, then you can take bath. But if your mind gets distracted within 5 minutes of your getting up, better start meditation soon after you get up. That was Swami's advice. Swami insisted that you should take vegetarian food. Swami said vegetarian food will increase your concentration. Non-veg food is sensuous, it will not help you in your meditation. Swami said that continuously, don't be in a hurry to get the results of meditation. Rishis used to pray for, do yoga, do dhyanam for years together to get that result. If you become hurried, Swami gives an example. A monkeys went to a mango top, and there mango trees had been planted. Every day they used to go to the mango top, they used to pluck the plant and see how deeper it has gone, how deeper the roots have gone. And at last they found that those plant saplings are not growing, because every day they were in a hurry to see that the tree gets generated. So also don't be in a hurry, that was Swami says, slowly and surely you will progress. The reflection, whether you are improving in dhyanam, is known when you, how cheerful you are, how cool you are against provocation, how much you are able to keep your mind still. This will give an indication how you are progressing in dhyanam. Japa is a beginning stage, it is a preliminary stage that will take you towards. Here you have an instrument, a japamala you have. Here this japamala you have, and this japamala has beads. The beads are temporary, but the string, the thread holding the beads is permanent. These beads are temporary. They will fall away, but this thread that holds together the beads, that is permanent. Sutre Maniganaiva, Bhagavad Gita says. So also these beads are like we people. We are temporary, but the thread within is Bhagavan. He is eternal. He doesn't go, but these things may fall. In a japamala you have here 42 beads. Then this japamala is very symbolic also. You have 5 fingers. These 5 fingers, these 3, index finger and these 2, ring finger and the other finger. These 3 represent the 3 gunas. This is tamoguna, this is rajoguna, this is sattvaguna. What are these gunas? Tamoguna is dullness, inactive. This is tamoguna. Rajoguna is overexcited, and sattvaguna is balanced. So this entire prakriti is constituted of three elements. Our body is also constituted of 3 elements. So when are you putting the japamala for meditation, for japa, you are putting this mala over this finger, this sadhu, which represents sattvaguna. So when you are turning the beads one by one, this is jiva, this is Brahma. Your objective is jiva Brahma aikya. Jiva should turn to become one with Brahma. So as you turn the beads, this jiva goes and touches the Brahman. This jiva goes and touches the Brahman. So it every time it indicates that jiva and Brahma are one. These 5 fingers will see that when they are closer to jiva and Brahma, when this finger becomes close, this is jiva Brahma. Here, this ring finger is very near to this. But if it goes away from jiva Brahma, then you will have these things away. So when the prakriti is near God, this is the thing, jiva Brahma ikya. You see where these fingers are. But if it goes away, then you see what is the gap. So our intention is that jiva and Brahma should be one. So in this japa mala, we can regularly practice it till we get a stage where without japa also, without this mala also, we can concentrate on the Lord. This is called ajapa japa. So this is for regular primers, those who are not practiced, who are not habituated to do dhyanam, they can start doing it with japa. Japamala, that will help them to go nearer to Bhagavan. So this is what dhyanam, japa. Then the third thing is likhita japa. Likhita japa is the easiest way of connecting ourselves to God. Here we don't require anything else except a likhita japa book and a pen. There is no time restraint. There is no restraint on the basis of caste, creed, color or religion. Anybody can do it. There is no restriction on age. Even children can do it. In Odisha, we had started a movement of 100 crore Likhitanamas. 100 crore Likhitanamas in 3 years. And this is something, a figure which Guinness Book of World Records should note. And this we started over a period of 3 years. We decided that Likhita Japa should be a habit with all. Likhita Japa books were printed in large numbers. Even pocket-sized books we had printed, so that you can carry it in the pocket while going on a journey or whenever you are free, you can light Likhita Japa. And this Likhita Japa had no restriction that only write Sai Ram. I said you can write Allah, you can write Jesus, you can write Vaheguru, you can write Rama, Krishna, Shiva, Shakti, you can write Swami. And these Likhita books find access into the jails where prisoners started writing. It went to the hospitals where the diseased person, the sick people, they started writing. And Swami had started this Likhita Japa movement. Once on the day this pillar, the Sarvadharma pillar here was, had said in his speech that this stupa is unique in the sense that a few days back I had created a medallion and shown it to the students. And on that medallion there was a map of India. And in that map, certain centers of spiritual excellence were identified. And one such center was at Bhuvaneshwar. None of us knew it, but ultimately we find that it is Bhagavan's will that this center should be, this stupa should be there in Odisha, Bhuvaneshwar. And on that day, Swami in his discourse said, those places where there will be a college, there will be no stupa, and where there is a stupa, there will be no college. But for us, God was gracious that we had started a college 35 years back and now we had a stupa which was completed within 6 months, and this is something that has been uniquely done. So this is the easiest process through which one can reach God. Now the thing is, if we do it, we will succeed. If we just hear it, if we just read it in the books, we will not succeed. Swami is very particular about practice. Swami is very particular about practice and he exemplifies it. He exemplifies it. In his life, he has stuck to what he has said. We should also be very particular that we stick to what Swami has asked us. Swami has given us the instructions. Are we following it? Are we following it? Do you really want ourselves to be connected with Him? This we should ask each one of us. Each one of us we should ask ourselves. And while going away from this conference, we should have the determination to put into practice whatever we have learnt here. Swami's formula is very simple. 9-point code of conduct. It is the easiest panacea for today's ills. And none of these points are difficult to observe. Swami says, do japa and dhyana. He didn't say that do japa and dhyana for 1 hour. He didn't say that you do it for 2 hours. Start doing it with 5 minutes. He said daily reading of Sai literature. He didn't say that you read 1 page or 2 pages. You read one line or one para of it and start reading it. He said don't criticize others, don't speak ill of others. If we are really engaged in sadhana, we will not have time to speak ill of others. But an idle man's brain is devil's workshop. Because our minds are idle, we speak ill of others. So in this way, if we find that whatever Swami has said in the 9-point code of conduct, nothing is difficult, very easy to implement, but we don't do it. 9-point code of conduct adorn the walls of our house. We say in a statement that Swami is the master of this house. We are all obeying whatever he says, but we don't do it practically. So this is where we lag behind. Swami says, unless you do what I have said, you cannot get the result. You bring a medicine from the doctor for your digestion in a very neat bottle inside a very good cover. You like that cover, you like that neat bottle, but you don't take the medicine. Can your disease be cured? So what is required is that we should implement, we should put into practice what Swami has said. Such simple prescription no one else can give. It is only Swami. If we follow His instructions, we will be successful in life. And the results of japa and dhyana we can get. The other scientific, the process and other things will be discussed in other classes. Here just I wanted to know, I wanted to tell you how important it is for us to do japa and dhyana. Each one can do it and can get the result and get the blessings of Swami, and we will be in His domain. Sai Ram, Dhanyavaad.